Father, we thank you for your presence. I'm just going to open up by reading out of Revelation chapter 5. Then I saw in the right hand of him who was seated on the throne a scroll written within and on the back, sealed with seven seals. I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the scroll and to break its seals?" And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or look into it. And I began to weep loudly because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or look into it. One of the elders said to me, "Weep no more. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and the seals." Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom, might, honor and glory and blessing. Father, we pray for the revelation of Christ to unfold among us this morning. Lord, I ask you to give us eyes to see, to behold our Savior, the one who has prevailed, the one who was found worthy. Give us eyes to see. Let our hearts be in union with him, as he is the one that was worthy and has redeemed us from all sorts of things. He has redeemed us and washed us and made us clean by his blood. And we declare, worthy is the Lamb of God this morning. Worthy is the Lamb of God this morning, whose blood is holy, whose life was given and raised up again, that you may have a family upon this earth, Lord. God, not only a family, but you've called forth a kingdom of priests, a kingdom of kings and a kingdom of priests to represent you on this earth. We declare glory, glory, glory to the Lamb of God. Glory, glory, glory to the one who is worthy. Glory, glory, glory to the one who reigns, the Almighty, the I Am, the Great Counselor, the Wonderful Mighty God. We declare you are worthy, O Lord Jesus, and may you roar over this region. May you roar over Tennessee. May you roar over the United States. May you roar worship him. Let's just stand on our feet. Let's just worship the Lamb who was slain but is now risen, whose life we live, in union with him, one with the Savior. Lord, you call forth the people, God, and we shall not cease to give you praise, God. There will be no rocks crying out in our place, for you are worthy.
Lift him up. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy. Come on. Holy. Are you flow with the Holy Spirit this morning.
Alleluia, for the Lord God Almighty reigns.
Descending out of this room this morning.
Oh, alleluia.
We partner with heaven this morning.
Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty.
Drink this morning. Churchianity is dying. Amen. Oh, all of our straight lines are becoming bent and twisted and wonderful and interesting, yeah?
The whole earth is waking up to what it means to be fully alive in Christ Jesus. Yeah. The church doesn't need another song. It doesn't need another conference. It doesn't need it doesn't need more rules and regulations. What it needs is the wine of Emmanuel's veins that it's neglected for so long. I just sense this morning that yes, God is ministering to his people, but I really feel like we're going to minister to Papa God this morning, yeah? With prayers and intercessions. If you're new here, I'm so sorry. You probably thought you were coming to a nice, cute little church, and I'm ruining your expectation. But our expectation this morning is for Jesus himself to walk through the wall, yeah? Everybody hold your hands out to heaven like this real quick. Everybody say, Jesus, let me see what you see. Let me feel what you feel. Let me know what you know. And let me hear what you hear. I hear the Lord say, don't be afraid of the silence this morning. I hear the Lord say, don't be afraid of the silence this morning. If you find comfort in noise, comfort and chaos, I'm gonna break you free this morning. For I am not the author of chaos, I'm the author of perfection. There's no such thing as too far gone. And for many, many, many of y'all this morning, it's been so long since you felt peace. It's been so long since you felt my presence. There's a wave of renewing. There's a wave of undoing this morning. A wave of undoing this morning. Some of you are addicted to chaos, addicted to commotion, addicted to trauma. It's like you've got to find a problem. Can't live without problems. But this morning, I want to set you free from yourself. Set you free from who you never were. And introduce you to who you're going to be from now on.
So much better your ways. comes my greatest defense. It leads me from the trial in wilderness. And all I did was pray. And all I did was worship.
That's all I did. I didn't do anything. Have a song to the Lord. Just sing it out to Him this morning. It doesn't have to sound pretty or completely on key. I just want you to make a holy noise unto Him.
The line of the
tribe of Judah, King of all nations, King of all the cosmos. He is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He makes all things new. He is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Oh, oh. I literally see like this big lion walking in the midst of the room right now. And I feel like there's an invitation from the Lord for everyone in the room to see it. So right now, if you're not seeing it, I just want you to say, Holy Spirit, open my eyes to see the Lion of the tribe of Judah. And the Lord told me some of you would literally see him different colors. Some of you would see him like in different ways. And I want you to conversate with the Holy Spirit about why he's revealing himself to you that way, or in that color, or in that manner.
He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah.
Open our eyes, God.
He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah.
Oh.
He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Ooh. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah.
Don't neglect seeing. Don't shut your eyes when he's trying to open them. Don't stop up your ears when he's speaking.
Leaders, if you guys have words of knowledge for healing already, just come down to join me. But I feel like God is wanting to heal this morning. And I know we always partner with God in healing, but as I was away for these last 8 days, chilling at the beach, praying, contemplating, just letting go of the busyness and being before the Lord, I felt the Lord start speaking to me to call us higher in healing. I mean, we've had breakthroughs, we've had tremendous healings, but not that I'm looking at quantity or even quality, but not to the magnitude of we've had breakthrough in deliverance. And I feel God just really resetting that in me and in this house. So all week I've just prayed and talked to the Lord about that. And for hours, all I did was listen to healing testimony. For hours and hours and hours and hours, I was listening to healing testimony, stirring up. You know, when we want to see God do more, we exercise our faith. We stir up the gift of God. This morning in prayer, when the Holy Spirit started moving, I mean, most of the time I'm roasting. I'm hot. But my hands have been ice cold this morning. From here down, my hands are ice cold, like there's not even circulation. It feels so cold. I've had all kinds of experiences, but usually my hands get hot. But it's there's a uniqueness this morning. So as I'm praying into that, I just hear the Lord responding back. Is it not what you've prayed for the last 8 days? He's wanting to come and move among us this morning. So leaders, if y'all have some words of knowledge, I want to invite you to come up. But I felt like God gave me three things. And we're gonna keep in worship. I'm going to walk back down here in just a moment. We're just going to keep on worshiping. But if this touches any of you guys, just come and see me over there. Because God often reveals things to us that He wants to heal. And if you're dealing with these conditions, you can trust that Holy Spirit's revealed that this morning. He is just offering that to you. So I felt like there was abdominal pain, kind of down on the right side, but you almost didn't come this morning because of just a fear of that pain stirring up. Also in the right side of the base of your neck, like piercing pain, I was feeling that, sensing that, and then also on the right foot, bone spurs. So is that anybody in here dealing with any of those things? Good. Anything? You guys just come over here and join me. I'm just going to pray for you guys. And leaders in the house, if you get words, just come up and grab the microphone. We're going to press into this. And we're going, not just this service, but going forward, this is going to be a very important, crucial part of what we're doing. So Seth, just take us back in. We're going to worship some more. This has been glorious all morning. So let's just worship.
I also felt the leading of the Lord earlier. I just feel like the Lord is speaking over us this morning. God wants you to get super comfortable this morning. Because I feel like there's like intercession that, yes, we've been kind of entering into. There's a whole nother level that we just haven't hit yet. But the thing about intercession is it doesn't have to be this, you know, stress, strive, straining thing. I mean, I know we don't teach that here, but intercession, like God wants you to find a spot with Him in the room. And maybe that's the seat that you're sitting in. But I feel like some of you, there's a spot in the room that the Lord would lead you to. And that's your act of faith, is to go there and meet Him there. And we're going to begin to intercede and enter into that time. So just keep your eyes and ears open.
So I also felt that same neck pain, like right there at the base of the skull. But there was also something with like head pain or headaches. But it wasn't just like a one-time thing. If you have a headache right now, absolutely, we'll pray for you. But it was more of like a recurring, there was something with the brain or the head that was causing pain and irritation.
And I was hearing something about the bladder, whether it's an infection or cancer, just anything with the bladder.
everyone sitting here, I hear the Lord giving us Isaiah 55, 5. But it starts with, come all you who are thirsty. Come all you who are thirsty. Come to the waters. And you without money, come, buy, and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why spend money on that which is not bread, and your labor on that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me, and eat what is good, and your soul will delight in the richest of foods. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen so that you may, your soul may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my loving devotion, promised to David.
Make us like children again in your presence. Renew childlike faith in this room.
Make us like children. Make us like children. From the head to the heart, you take me on a journey. Let it
take me on a journey and letting go, getting lost in you from the head to the heart. You take me on a journey and letting go, getting lost in you.
Come on.
Soften your heart this morning. Let him soften your heart. joy. I've got the joy. Prophesy now. I've got the joy. Let it out now. I've got the joy. Let it out now. I've got the joy. To the devil. Ha, 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 ha. Laughing in the face of the devil. Hey, singing ha, 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 ha. Oh, we're laughing in the face of the devil. Hey, ha, 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 ha. Oh, laughing in the face of the devil. You try. Ha, 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 ha.
Laughing in the face of the devil.
Watch out now.
Ha, 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 ha. Laughing in the face of the devil.
Ah, ha, 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 ha. Laughing in the face of the devil.
Yeah, come on, give Jesus a shout right now. Several of you all received prayer for healing. Anybody have 80% more healing manifest? Not that you're believing for it, but any? Jason, what was it? Your neck? Come here, come here, come here. So that I can hear you.
A lot of vertigo issues, eye issues. I had a massive head injury 13 years ago, and so they've naturally fused themselves together. But God, like, yeah, I don't have any pain right now at all, so.
Woo!
It's normally about a 7 on a regular basis. If I sleep wrong, 9, it's a 0 right now. So, yeah.
Hallelujah. Anybody else have anything manifest, healing manifest? What was it, dear? Huh? Your neck? Come on, come here. Tell us what it was before, how it is now.
Yeah, I suffer from, I'm trying to get rid of, yeah, from, spinal stenosis in my neck. I have a neck of a 90-year-old, and so I have a hard time moving it, and Tyler prayed for me, and I can move it to the side, to the back, to the side, so I have like 85%, so yeah.
So was it mobility? So let's just pray. Did anybody else have healing manifest this morning, 80% or more? Anybody else? Okay. Well, we're going to pray for her. We want to just go 100% right now. Father, we bless our sister right now. I thank you for a reversal of what was to come into what is the new covenant, full healing, full mobility. Neck, move the way you were designed in the name of Jesus. Just check it out one more time for us. No pain. We'll set, and we want the 100% mobility. Thank you for sharing. So I'm just happy to say my hands feel normal again. That was the most unique thing. I mean, I've had lots of crazy experiences, but that was wild this morning. And I think it was God further activating something among us as the family. So, yeah, I'm going to receive an offering. Is anybody happy about that? Yay. Yeah, so we're going to receive an offering this morning. If you would like to give, make checks to the well. You can give online, text to give, however you desire. Also, I haven't looked at the numbers, so I'm not going to say. We're still, if you would like to designate any giving to Asia, please write that on your envelope. and turn that in. Also on the website, there's links there that you can select Asia. And if you are giving towards a team members, make sure you select their name. There's under their name, there's some information there that you can select to designate that giving towards the team. Looks like we have 13 people going to Asia with us. At least there's 13 airline tickets purchased in those 13 people's name. So they better be going. No, I'm just kidding. So I want to pray over this offering before we receive it. Holy Spirit, we thank you for the heart of your people. Lord, I thank you for healing people that have been manipulated and abused and prostituted through giving. Lord, I pray that there's never a person that is manipulated in this house, but Lord, that you would cause our hearts to be so developed to actually be able to experience what a cheerful giver is in the new covenant. So Lord, take our hearts, just begin to multiply the cheerfulness. Lord, it's something we can't make happen, but you can cause us to see and to understand and to comprehend what you have put in place of sowing and reaping and the cheerfulness of being a giver. So God, I bless those in this house, those that are already in that cheerful giving understanding, those that are coming into it. But Lord, I just pray for healing over every person that's ever been abused through offerings, through tithing, through giving. If you're in this place right now, I bless you with freedom to not give. But I bless your heart with healing that you can, as a son and as a daughter, experience the joyfulness of giving without compulsion and fear. So Lord, I break off all manipulation and all fear off of your people. I release them from fear of being cursed by you. Release the blessings of the new covenant in and through them. In Jesus' name. Guys, go ahead and receive the offering. So, how'd Amy do last week? Awesome as always, right? We get her again this morning. Come on, Amy. Let's welcome Amy.
Trusting me for a doubleheader. All right, but before I get into that, I got a couple announcements. Foundations class today, after service. WSSM begins tomorrow. Yay! Woohoo! It's going to be awesome. Those of you who, it's still not too late to sign up. You can. So if you have been putting it off and are like me, procrastinate till the very last second, now's your chance. Sign up. It will be awesome. If you don't believe me, ask. So who all's been through at least year one of WSSM? Yay. Ask one of these people. They will tell you about it. I'm just going to say this. I remember after the second year we were sitting, we were just as a group talking, and one person said it the best way about WSSM. And what she said was, every lesson, I found a new way to understand how much God loves me. And to me, it's like, okay, we did our job. If people can go through the terms and come out with that, then we've done it. Deliverance Seminar is August 20th. There'll be the beginning session in the morning, intermediate session in the afternoon. So sign up on that website, But if it's just an opportunity, we are a house that believes in freedom. We are a house that believes in wholeness. So I'm very excited about what Mike just did, because I believe Jesus came to set the people free and heal the sick. I mean, how many times in the scripture does he, and he cast out demons and healed them, and he cast out demons and healed them. So we want people whole. And that's what we are in the kingdom business is about, making whole people. The Gatekeepers Conference, that is in October, the 20th through the 22nd. Sign up on the website. It will be amazing. We have prophetic words about how we are gatekeepers of the region. We're going to use this time to explore that, understand what that means, and really just advance forward. Youth tonight. So yay. If you've got youth, send them. If you want to find out what it's about, Josh and Jen. But, you know, the truth of the matter is we are dealing with generational issues. The enemy is attacking the youth. The culture wars are a war against our youth, and we need to be, as a church, addressing that. And then last but not least, in the backs of your seats, there are Connect cards. If this is your first time here, please fill one out and then go see under where it says Connect in the lobby. Just go visit the people who will be manning the table there. We just love to get to know you better. No pressure. We will have a little gift for you. But more importantly, we just want to get to know you, because in the end, it's about family. And don't think, oh, I'm driving through, I'm just here for one day. We want to get to know you. So even if you don't want to ultimately make this your church home, that is still okay. All right. So, yes, I said that first.
I'm just so excited about it.
I know. And who can blame you? Sorry, I didn't linger on foundations class. I could go back and announce it again, can I? Foundations class, following service today. All right. So last week I spoke about in being a son or daughter, the importance of knowing who your father is. Knowing God as our father and knowing him for who he says he is, not for who religion and who our natural parents have taught us that he is. And this week I want to continue somewhat along the same lines, but instead of talking about what God teaches us about being a son and daughter, the question is, what does Jesus show us? Because in the end, Jesus is really the model son. If we, Romans 8:29 says, "For those whom he, God, foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers." So Jesus came to lead the way as a son. Now, you know, Jesus is many things in Scripture. He's Savior. So we want to always maintain that role. He's our bridegroom. He's Messiah. He's servant. But today I want to talk about Jesus as son. And one of the things that I love about Jesus is, like 672 things, is that in displaying his sonship, Jesus actually understood how to balance being and being in his identity of I am a son, but also recognize that being also needed doing. So he was a son. He never compromised his identity as a son. He completely understood that, but he also operated and behaved out of his sonship. But he didn't confuse the two. He behaved perfectly as a son, but his being as a son was not tied up in his doing as a son. So we one thing we need to learn is, yes, we need to understand how to be a son or daughter, and we need to learn how to do. But when we are imperfect in our doing, it doesn't affect our being. All right, that's my sermon. Go, Amy. All right. In preparing for this, I asked myself, you know, there are actually two occasions where God himself declares, Jesus is my son. And we will often talk about the baptism. The other occurrence is the transfiguration, which, yeah, it's just that you sort of, once you start thinking about it, your head goes really, starts exploding. Intriguingly, the transfiguration occurs in three of the Gospels. So the baptism occurs in all four, but John, for whatever reason, opts not to relate it. But so Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And what, in studying and preparing this, I started to unfold some of the similarities. So we'll start with the next slide. All right. And so I'm going to use Matthew here as my first main text. And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them to a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. You'll notice I've bolded after. I'm going to talk about that in just a minute. But he was transfigured before them. You know, one of the things that is in our inheritance is this ultimate, when Jesus comes around, we talk about our resurrected bodies, our glorified bodies. Jesus is displaying here. Here on earth, we start to see what our inheritance looks like in the second coming. When we talk about, when, you know, we don't have to pray for deliverance and we don't have to pray for healings because we operate from this perfect body. That's part of our inheritance as sons and daughters. That's a good inheritance. That's our ultimate destiny as children. But now it gets even more interesting. Okay, next slide. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. And Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make three tents for here, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah. Now, we often make fun of Peter because, you know, he was quick to talk, slow to think. And he's like us. But I'm telling you what, can you imagine? There's Jesus kneeling. He starts glowing. I mean, that's the only way to describe it. So, turned so dazzling white. And then clearly Moses, clearly Elijah, right there, and you can see him. I mean, the freak out would have been understandable. So, however, if he wasn't freaked out enough, what happened? The big thing really happens. While he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. The cloud throughout Scripture means one thing: the very presence of God. Now, God manifests himself other ways, but when they talk about a cloud, it is God himself showing up. So there's no doubt. And here Peter, James, and John see and hear God say, This is my beloved Son. Listen to him. Now, what's interesting is this listen to him actually to Peter, James, and John would have evoked the Old Testament, would have evoked a very specific passage from Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy 18:15, which says, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me," and this is Moses speaking, "from among you, from your countrymen, you shall listen to him." So here they have, in the presence of Moses, God saying, "Listen to him." They just made this big connection now. Sometimes I can be slow, but even I can make that connection. But here we have God declaring Jesus' identity. And when you look at that Romans passage, we are equally sons and daughters. So if God is declaring, God declares our identity as sons and daughters. Jesus, you don't see Jesus arguing with God. Jesus is accepting the declaration of heaven over his life. How many of us struggle with the declaration of heaven over our life? Thank you. I thought I was alone in the room. Thank you. One of the things that we're called to do is you know, we talk about, hey, we, you know, you read these statements, and I am a son or a daughter, and I am beloved, and I am, and I am. We read these biblically based declarations about our identity because hopefully we start to believe them. Yeah, that's the intention. You know, they say that you're 80% more likely to believe something you hear yourself say than you hear somebody else say. So start speaking over your life. We, as a church, need to start standing in agreement with what God is saying. And one of the big things he says time and time again is, "You are a son, you are a daughter, I am pleased with you." Galatians 4:7 says, "So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God." That's one we can meditate on and let it sink in. All right, now I'm going to go quickly through the next couple slides. So if we look, however, as I said, this passage of the transfiguration occurs in three of the Gospels. So in Mark, we see effectively the same thing. "And after 6 days, Jesus took him with him, Peter, James, and John, and he was transfigured, and the cloud overshadowed them, and the voice came out, 'This is my beloved son, listen to him.' And suddenly, looking around, they saw no one, only Jesus." And then again in Luke, "Now after about 8 days." All right, I want to pause a second, because a lot of people go, "Wait, 6, 6, 8. That's a contradiction. That just proves that there's something wrong with the Bible." All right, "I spoke about 8 days ago, or after 6 days. I spoke last day, so after 6 days, I'm speaking again." It just depends on, do you count the days of? So I can go Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and that's 8. Or I can go Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and that's 6. So they're not doing different. They just include, because they don't have the, actually, they don't talk about week in Roman times. It's just a different way of counting the days. One in which they include the days of, and one in which they include the days between. Okay? So that was a rabbit trail, but I had to say it. Because sometimes we'll have people tell us that the Bible is inconsistent. And this proves why you shouldn't believe the Bible over silly things where we don't understand the culture. All right. And again, and I like the Luke passage sometimes a little better, because the Luke actually highlights, "And as he was praying." So we talk about this, the importance of prayer and this communication with the Father. So if you're struggling, get on your knees. Start talking to your dad. Start engaging in the way to be in the presence is talk to the one who has the presence. But, and here I want to talk a little bit more. So this is great because this tells us about this understanding, the being of sonship. But I'm actually, as much time as I spent on the Transfiguration, I'm not going to talk about the Transfiguration today. Because as I said, what really intrigued me was this after. There is some event, all three accounts of the Transfiguration connected to something that has occurred a week earlier. All three of them. What is that? And in fact, what happens, there's some things that happen after. So what do we learn about being a son from understanding the before and the after? As much as, so here we have Jesus in the being, but what do we understand about the doing? So go to the next slide. This is the busy slide. So what we see here is this, the Transfiguration sits in the middle of a sequence of events. And we'll start with Peter's confession of Jesus as the Christ at Caesarea Philippi. And we know that one. Who do people say that I am? And they say, oh, here's what other people say. And Jesus goes, but who do you say I am? So clearly they're linking the Transfiguration, God's declaration of who Jesus is. How does that align with what people say? Well, other people, not sons, not daughters, say you're Elijah, say you're one of the prophets, say you're just a good guy, a moral teacher. But we say you're the Christ. You are the anointed one of God. So we're linking, and Jesus affirms this in all three accounts. He said, yes, and upon this rock I will build my church. And I want to hold a thought. Matthew talks about, also gives I will give you the keys of the kingdom. Whatever you bind on earth shall have been bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall have been loosed in heaven. I'm going to make a connection with that later. So just anchor on that. But so we have this, the confession of Jesus as Christ. That starts this, what happened. But there's really, it isn't that verse passage in isolation. Because again, all three gospels roll through the same steps. And some of these are word for word the same. So the next thing that happens is Jesus then says, but I'm going to Jerusalem, I'm going to die, and after 3 days I'll be raised again. And Peter says, no, you won't. And what does Jesus say? Get behind me, Satan. I'm a son or a daughter. I have a destiny. That destiny sounds painful, but it is important. Who is here to thwart our destiny? It's not God. It's not Jesus. Sometimes it is the enemy in the form of friends and family. Amen? But it's certainly the enemy. So when we have this destiny, we need to understand our destiny because we understand our identity and we understand what we're called to do. But then Jesus goes right from there into what I call his declaration of true discipleship. And I'll talk a little bit about that in a second. Also now, so we then go up the mountain, Transfiguration event, and all three Gospels tell the exact same story when he comes down off the mountain. And that's the father of the demon-possessed boy comes to Jesus and says, your disciples couldn't do it. My son is tormented, and he throws himself in the fire. Why couldn't? You need to help. You need to help. And Jesus, you know, I could go into this passage for a long time. But Jesus says this kind only comes out through prayer and fasting. This is a doing piece. But when we think prayer is about intimacy. You want to understand, and as I said, Jesus was praying. That's what we saw in the Luke account of the Transfiguration. And again, here we see all the Gospels reported again, prayer and fasting. I think Mark's the one who actually specifically calls out prayer and fasting. So here we have intimacy. Jesus models sonship by modeling the importance of being intimate with your Father. God isn't going to abandon us as sons and daughters, but if we want to grow, if we want to understand, if we want to move in that, it is about intimacy. And then there's that pesky word, and fasting. And you're going, but hey, Amy, isn't this a works religion? And I'm going to tell you no, because fasting is about self-denial. And we, as sons and daughters, are not called to pursue what we want. So again, we see this this sequence of, we have this demon-possessed boy. And I do find it interesting that the event with Peter, he talked about binding and loosing. And then the first event in sort of a parallel structure of this boy is a binding and a loosing, is a removing of the demonic. So that if we look at these first three, they offer like an A, B, C, and then they're repeated again, A, B, C, in terms of a parallel structure. Because we see a confession of the church, a binding and loosing, a dealing with the demonic, a how the kingdom is progressing. Then we also see Jesus' revelation of his death. He talks about his death the second time. And then the next one, what does true discipleship or true greatness, what's the cost of discipleship? And they're all pretty much, again, the same. Now, Matthew sticks in a little bit between these, so he's not, but you can look at these verses. They are sequential in all the passages. The Transfiguration sits in this core of the being, but the doing is swirling around. He is my son, listen to him. It's about intimacy. And it is about denying one's self. Let's go to the next slide. Okay. Now, you notice I've titled this Sonship. And he, that's Jesus, said to all, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses or profits himself? But Amy, that's about discipleship. That's not about sonship. I have been taught this passage for the last 35 years, and it's always taught about the cost of discipleship. It's always taught about how to be a disciple. See, he even says, and follow me. That's a discipleship verse. Well, when Mary and his brothers come, and Jesus is teaching, and they say, and they can't, and his family, his blood relatives can't get to him. And they say, Jesus, your mother and your brothers are outside waiting for you. What does Jesus say? This is my family. Jesus doesn't see a distinction. One of the amazing things about Christianity that I think we do not embrace to what it really means is that when we step into discipleship, because we're stepping into covenant with a Father, we are stepping into relationship with Jesus. This is family. To be a disciple is to be a son. You want to understand what it means to be a son and what's the, it's a choice. It's about being a disciple. It's about following Jesus, our Lord and Savior, who models perfect sonship for us. Let him deny himself. And this word deny, it's actually a legal term, and it means complete disownment. What Jesus modeled as perfect sonship was an abandonment of his desires to God's desires. And he's teaching, again, this now occurs after. I'm sorry, this one occurs before. This one occurs immediately before Jesus says, is told, God says, listen to him. God said, listen to him. So I think God saying, listen to him, still applies. Listen to him. Take up his cross daily. And this, I am going to say this firmly. Your cross to bear is not sickness and disease. Your cross to bear is not tormenting evil spirits. But it is actually harder to take up the cross daily of submitting, because the cross to Jesus is always about choosing the Father's will over my will. The way Jesus said modeled sonship was to go to the cross. It was to choose God. But every day, Jesus was, even before he went to the cross, every day Jesus was aligning with the Father's will. Jesus was choosing what God chose before what he wanted. Go to the last slide. I'm going to end early today, yay. Luke 22:42. So this is Jesus in the garden, and we know this one very well. Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. This is Jesus's moment of decision. And we all know Jesus had the decision. But the decision wasn't to go to the cross or not. The decision was to submit. The decision was to choose God's will. Because that's what the fall was all about. Humanity in the garden chose what they wanted over what God wanted. And you notice I'm not saying will, I'm saying want. Often we hear this term will, and we think God's will, and we think, hey, he created the heavens and the earth. It's God's will, like this iron fist that's holding our heads beneath the water and forcing us to do something. That there is a coercion associated with, because we talk about people of iron will. And there is this inherent sense that there was coercion. There was zero coercion in this. But when we actually look at this word in the Greek that means, that's being used for will, it's thelo. And it mean, and one meaning is to will or to have in mind, but it also means to desire. It means to take delight in or have pleasure. It means to love, as in to be fond of doing. What Jesus is saying here is Jesus is making a love choice. What Jesus is really saying is, Father, I love you more than I love what I want. Father, as your son, I am choosing what will make you happy. I am choosing to do what's your heart's desire. You want to be a son or a daughter? Choose to pursue God's heart. God is looking for sons and daughters with whom he can trust his heart. Jesus was perfect because God could trust him fully with his heart. The doing part of being a son or a daughter is saying, God, I really want to go do this, but I know it will make you happy if I do this other thing. It is about aligning with his heart. It's not a set of rules that he will punish you for if you don't do them. Because it is just simply, when we seek him, we are seeking to make him happy. You know, isn't in whom I am well pleased, but wouldn't that be great if we go to heaven and God says, you made me happy. That's what I want. I want that in the natural for people I care about. I want them to be happy. I want to do things that I will give them gifts that I know please them. I will do, you know, I don't vacuum at home because I like to vacuum. I vacuum at home because my mom likes it when I vacuum. Trust me. And we laugh, but sometimes it is as simple as that. I'd rather watch TV, but it makes my mom happy when I vacuum. Do I score points? No. Do I do it to score points? No. I used to. But that's what relationship's about. That's what family's about. That's what, you know, yes, we are a son, our daughter. We are going to be exalted with our big brother. We are reigning and ruling up there with Christ. You know, Christ in us in Christ. I mean, it's this kind of head-boggling thing, and that's great. That's our who. That's not our do. Let's do what makes God happy. God, not what makes me happy, but what makes you happy. Change the words from will to what your heart's desire. God, not this little thing that I want to do that in 10 minutes I'll have forgotten I done. Eat that donut. But what makes you happy? And I want to do, you know, God, He talks time and time again in the Old Testament and the New Testament. He wants our hearts. Jesus came to model what it means to be a son devoted to the heart of his Father. I have no place to go from here. Michael, you get to land the plane.
I want to point something out. I mean, how many of you all, her message just causes you to want to just give up your will and receive the Father's desires? I mean, it wants us to. Would you say you've had any challenging aspect to that this morning? I mean, has Holy Spirit brought things to your mind that he's wanting you to lay down? Anybody? Yeah? Thank you. You were very honest. Anybody else? Yeah, that's Olive. No, I appreciate it. That's what I want. We need people to. Sometimes the well, because we talk about the love of the Father so much, which is like one of the greatest revelations of mankind, I believe. But we've been accused in the past of not preaching repentance. But I just want to point something out. Do you realize probably a good portion of this room this morning has already repented in your heart as you heard the drawing and the revelation of the word? It's causing you to turn from one direction because God did something in your heart, and it's causing you to go a different way. You had one desire and maybe didn't realize it, but as she opened up and unlocked the word to us, and Holy Spirit is bringing stuff out, it's caused that unlocking inside has caused you to turn more to Him. That's actually repentance. It's not being harsh and beating people and abusing them, if you will, and just, you know, making this hard on somebody. That doesn't always bring about repentance. Most of the time it brings about a fear of judgment. But when the word is actually unlocked by the Holy Spirit and a gifted teacher, it causes our hearts to turn to Him and causes our lives to further line up with Him. And that's actually repentance. Genuine repentance. The goodness of God drawing us to repentance. Now, absolutely, there is a time for strong rebuke. And that is generally towards a very rebellious group or oftentimes religious leaders. There is a time for that. But sons and daughters that are pursuing Him, we don't want to rebuke. We want to unlock further revelation of the Word, further revelation of Jesus. Jesus being the model Son. That was a beautiful message, Amy. So let's just stand on our feet. I want to have our ministry team come up. And as I dismiss you guys this morning, come and receive ministry. You're welcome to find a place in an altar and pray if you're wanting to let Holy Spirit work deeper. If you want a prayer team to minister to you, they're coming up. Come on down. Come on down. They'll be glad to pray with you. And I will see in 10 minutes those interested in learning more about the well. I'll see you guys in this first classroom right over here. Father, I thank You that You're calling us as a body to take up Your desire in our hearts. As we take up Your desires, our desires just slowly begin to slip away. Our desires to be good sons and daughters by both being and the doing flowing forth from that. So Lord, I bless this family this morning. God, and I commission them to go out to this region of Tennessee to proclaim the gospel of the kingdom, to heal the sick, to raise the dead, to cleanse the lepers, and to be model sons and daughters that reflect a good Father in Jesus' name. Let's come on down and receive ministry. Thank you guys for coming out this morning. Bless you guys. We'll see you back here Thursday night. And if you are in the School of Supernatural Ministry, we'll see you here at 7 o'clock tomorrow. Blessings.